Congressman McGarvey, thank you so much for joining us. You pushed for a red flag law in Kentucky State Senate when you were serving there, and then you renewed that call after the mass shooting at Old National Bank. What would it take for something like that to pass in the U.S. Congress?
Hey, you know, unfortunately, we're seeing so many more mass shootings in this country. It's impacting everywhere, from California to Louisville to Nashville to Connecticut. You're seeing this all across the country. And as more communities are just ripped apart through senseless gun violence, you see people saying, what can we do? And these red flag laws give a really great tool to law enforcement, to families, to communities, to say, when somebody's in trouble, when they're in crisis and they're a danger to themselves or to others, that temporary removal of a firearm sometimes just gives enough of a break that it can save lives.
But there are people in Congress who don't want to give an inch. Mm-hmm. How do you get past that?
You know, we can't give up. So I've joined the Gun Violence Prevention Task Force. And one of the things we are doing right now is we have a list of members that we're going to talk to, members from across the aisle, one-on-one, not in front of the cameras, not for the press, not to put on social media, saying gun violence is a problem in this country. Where can you meet us? What can we do? From mental health to the guns themselves, where can you meet us to make sure that we're keeping our community safe?
Tell us a little bit about that Gun Violence Prevention Task Force. Mm-hmm. When was it formed and who's on it?
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure when it was formed, but the Gun Violence Prevention Task Force is members of Congress who get together, who just say, where's the legislation? What can we do? What can we push forward? How can our policy actually help people and help communities stay safe?
Now, to be devil's advocate, mm-hmm. there are a lot of people who are concerned about protecting constitutional rights and ensuring that due process is maintained with something like a red flag law. Mm-hmm. So how do you structure it to make sure that people's rights are protected and that everybody gets due process?
We did this in Kentucky, and I think it can be a template for the rest of the nation. When Whitney Austin, who lives here, was walking into work in Cincinnati, she was shot 12 times as part of a mass shooting. Unbelievably, she survived. And when she got home here to the Highlands, I met with her. And she said, what can we do? We started looking at the laws. We started looking at things that could help. And she came up with this idea of a crisis aversion rights retention order, a sort of red flag law. We got Republican support, not just Republican support, but rural Republican support. Because what it does is it says only law enforcement can petition a judge for this type of crisis aversion rights retention orders. That means law enforcement has looked into it. They believe someone is a danger to themselves or others. They take it in front of a judge. A judge then believes that that person is an immediate threat to themselves or to others. It's a temporary, and I stress temporary, removal of a firearm, where then, within a short window, that person is back in front of the court. In our statute, we had a court-appointed attorney for that person who makes sure that their rights are protected, but also that they are protected, that their life is protected. Now, look, I believe we have to have a holistic conversation on guns in our community and in our country. And a holistic conversation means, it means mental health. It means guns. It means recognizing that 60% of the gun deaths in this state and in this country are death by suicide. And so I think that these type of extreme risk protection orders or crisis aversion rights retention orders or red flag laws are a good marriage of mental health and common sense gun policy.
How much did the mass shooting at Old National Bank renew your zeal for going after this particular kind of legislation?
You know, I've never lost my zeal for going after this type of legislation. What the Old National Bank shooting did is it actually, at first it knocked me down. I knew people who were in there. I have one of my friends is one of the people who was killed. And so the first thing it did is it knocked me down. And then I think, like so many times in life, you've got to get back up. And so in getting back up, unfortunately, and really unfortunately, I just wish we had those people back. I wish our community hadn't experienced that. But now it gives me more of a platform to stand on in D.C. and say, this happened in Louisville, Kentucky. This happened in our town where everybody knows each other. And we don't want it to happen anywhere else. And so I make sure that this is a big part of what I'm doing in Congress, is pushing for these common sense gun reform laws so that there's mass shootings, whether it's suicide, whether it's just everyday gun violence, which I don't think gets enough attention either, just shootings that happen in our community. what are the policies we are putting in place to keep people safe from gun violence?
If I could touch on everyday gun violence in our community, is there some legislation that you think would target the most violent offenders in our community? And we already have laws that are supposed to prevent convicted felons from accessing guns, but does something additional need to be done there to target those most violent offenders in our community?
Yeah, instead of strengthening our gun laws and keeping people safe, the state of Kentucky is weakening our gun laws and not keeping people safe. And a great example of that is getting rid of the permit that you need to carry a concealed weapon. So now not only are people not getting training on when to use deadly force, we've seen this play out across the country as well, whether it's shooting someone who comes to the door, shooting the cheerleader for getting in the wrong car, no one's getting that training on when to use a firearm. But now you can just carry a gun pretty much whenever and wherever you want without having that license. And so one thing is, if police officers stop someone who's carrying a gun without a concealed carry weapon, there's nothing they can do about it. Whereas opposed to before, someone who might have had a wreck or something, if the cops don't have ready access to that, then that's something else they could have stopped. I mean, we've got to make sure that we are targeting gun violence in this country. And that means everything from background checks, universal background checks, which this country supports, that again would make sure that people who aren't supposed to have guns don't get guns. There's not that big glaring gun show loophole out there where you can just go buy a gun without a background check. I mean, that's a way to keep guns out of the hands of dangerous people. And then making sure, again, the high capacity magazines, looking at things like safe storage laws, we've got to come together and say, what are we doing to make sure we're keeping people safe?
You touched on universal background checks. Mm-hmm. That was one last question that I had about gun control before I shift gears a little bit. But mm-hmm. how close do you think Congress is to that, and what kind of needs to be done to tip those no votes on universal background checks?
It's something that over 90% of Americans want. I think the big stumbling block here is the corporate gun lobby in the NRA. And what we've got to do is convince our colleagues that they can stand up to that corporate gun lobby and still get reelected. I mean, this is everything. You mentioned universal background checks. Not just universal background checks. Let's talk about safe storage laws for a second. Last year, 80 kids went to Norton Children's Hospital with gunshot wounds. 85% of those were accidental. Think about that. 85% of the kids going to Norton Hospital had accidental gunshot wounds. That means that those accidental shootings were 100% preventable. Our policies just haven't kept up with keeping kids safe.
Would you say red flag, universal background, and safe storage laws, would those be top three in your mind? Or
I think we have to do everything we can in this instance. And I'm tired of people saying there's nothing we can do when we're doing nothing. I think that the laws we've seen that could be effective, certainly mental health, making sure we have mental health resources, making sure we have those red flag laws, that we have universal background checks, that we have waiting periods, that we're banning weapons of war from our streets. We saw the weapon that tore apart the old National Building and has been used in several other mass shootings in this country. So there is a laundry list of things we need to do. It's hard to rank them in order, but I think we need to do everything we can to keep people safe.
Do you support a ban on assault weapons?
I do. Yeah, I do. I think these are weapons of war. And you know what? We're not looking to take away any weapons that people use for hunting or even to keep themselves safe. These are used to hunt humans, and that's what they're used to do, and I don't think they have any place on our streets.
We know that the shooter had mental health problems, and he's not alone. The American Psychological Association, the World Health Organization, have all sort of sound the alarm that mental health conditions are increasing in prevalence. Mm-hmm. Is there something that Congress can do about this, and what should they do about it, if so?
Yeah, even the Surgeon General has sounded the alarm and said, we've got to be putting more resources into mental health. And I think that is something that Congress can do immediately, is put more resources into mental health. It should be as easy to get an appointment with a mental health counselor as it is to buy a weapon in this country. And one of the things we can do is up the reimbursement rates that go to mental health counseling, because I think not only will that encourage more people to get into the mental health field, it's going to make it easier to provide treatment.
That's good. And you were in Congress when they passed the Bipartisan Safer Communities mm-hmm. Act, but do you see opportunities to expand that legislation beyond increasing that reimbursement rate?
I do, and that's why I'm still optimistic. We saw last year the logjam finally broke free, a bipartisan bill that dealt with guns. And we've just got to build on that. And that's why we're doing this hard work. That's why I'm on the Gun Violence Prevention Task Force. That's why a lot of what we're doing is not flashy. It's not on social media. It's not out there calling somebody a name or pointing fingers at somebody else. It's saying, this is for all of us. These are all of our communities. These are all of our kids. I mean, every parent in the country should have been forced to go to school after Uvalde. I know how we felt. And so, you know, we've got to make sure that that doesn't happen again. And what are we doing on a policy level? I'm not saying we can stop everything from happening, but what are we doing on a policy level to even just keep one more person alive?
Is there anything going on in D.C. right now this summer that you think will address either gun control or mental health that lawmakers are realistically close to? I'm not talking pie in the sky.
No, we are working really hard on this. In fact, we're working towards a deadline, sort of an artificial deadline, but June is Gun Violence Prevention Month. And so as we're looking towards June, we're really trying to put an emphasis on where can you meet us, where can we come together and get something passed through the United States House of Representatives.
Do you feel like you're making any progress or any particular areas where you are making progress?
I do feel like we're making progress, particularly on the mental health front. And look, what I'm noticing now, at least is in private conversations, people recognize the problem. When we agree on the problem, then that's when we can have constructive dialogue on the solutions. And I think that's going on right now. Whether it can happen this year with Kevin McCarthy as Speaker of the House, I think we have yet to see. But it's not going to keep us from continuing to try.
Those are all the questions I have for you. Is there something I didn't ask you about that you want to mention?
I think we have to talk about gun violence with data. Over 14,000 people have been killed by gun violence this year. There have been over 225 mass shootings alone this year in the United States. And that number's likely out of date just from what's happened before I came in here to talk to you. This is a problem that is uniquely American. And so we've got to examine the laws and the policies that make at least some of this possible. And if we don't address those, then it is going to continue to happen. It is going to be someone else who's on the floor of the United States House of Representatives making a speech honoring the victims in their community like I had to do, because it's not going to stop until we do something about it.
Congressman McGarvey, thank you for your time.
Cool. Thank you.